So at the beginning, I wanted to make my presentation on criminalization aspects. But I would like to explain a little bit, change my presentations, and I would like to speak about trust and criminalization. And at the beginning, I would like to show some couple of slides, and will explain why I changed it a little bit. We conducted during past 4 years three researches. Yes, how our residents trust in law enforcement institutions. Second one, it was about corruption. And third one, what I would like to introduce, it was in sociology, by biographical approach. We are analyzing remembrance of Soviet time. So, and it was question, do you think most people can be trusted or they have to be treated with caution? And you see only 14% say you can trust people. So, first question, why? Why we distrust others? Second one question. It was about question about bribery. Generally, our citizens think that bribery is a big problem in our society, yes? We have to solve that problem. At the same time, our citizens say, if I will have some problems, I will pay or I will bribe somebody because it's very important for me. So second question, why? It's double mentality. I understand that corruption is a problem in our society. At the same time, in my behavior model, I am able to bribe somebody. And last one, so it shows that our residents distrust in political parties. Red color, it shows how much. In parliament, government, and law enforcement institutions. Question, why? Because now we have results from positions of our citizens. How they evaluate our institution, how we trust each other, yes? And I would like to start from one example and to show how some scenarios of criminalization can influence trust. And let me, you take one example. Head of a state tax inspectorate under the Ministry of Finance changed. It happened 6 months ago. And he, getting in front of camera, he said, just now, criminal liability will be visited only on those whose behavior has criminal elements. So, you hear? He publicly said that now people can sleep. So it questioned what happened before. And the message was aimed at the public, general public. What does this message say? This means that people are not protected from being criminalized. Trust policy can be illustrated or not a criminalization policy can be illustrated such way. We divided our geographical society where we live in two spheres, paradise and hell, yes? And first direction, when we are living in paradise, it means when our behavior is according rules, that time, yes? And when we break the rules, some rules, then police, prosecutor office, or other for enforcement institutions, they came help to us, yes? When we are criminalized, because we did something wrong. It's one direction let's say, criminalization, yes? And when we can analyze how we trust in such way. But there are some second behavior, some second scenario. When we stay, it means first scenario, that we all live in paradise, we do something wrong, and when we go, or we are sending into hell, yes? But according to this, my first example, what it means? That we are living, or we are stay at the beginning, yes? We are putting in hell, and then we should show that we are not people who breaks rule. It means exists second direction, from hell to the paradise. And what is interesting, the goal is the same. We are members of democratic all European Union. We are living according rules, yes, but two ways. So they have different influence. They have different influence for criminalization, and differently they influence our trust. So, and I think that what I showed with distrust is according to that scenarios. And the second scenarios influenced our trust in law enforcement institution, in political parties, and so on. And second one, I would like to talk more about one aspect of mistrust. Because trust and mistrust is not is a problem or portrait of nowadays. It's our experience in the past, and not only our experience, because communicative family memories has big influence, and experience in the life in past influence our feeling and trust today. And I would like show why I think so. Now I would talk about another study, and this is a qualitative study to the Soviet topic. So project was conducted in 2010-2012, and it calls Remembrance of Soviet Time, and we I mentioned before we just use biographical approach, Robert Miller's and Daniel Berthaud methodology. During that project, 185 biographic interviews were collected in Lithuania, Germany, Israel, and Poland. And we interviewing respondents age 40 years and older who lived in Lithuania during Soviet times. The main focus was on older people with longer Soviet time experience. For Lithuania, as well for all communist countries, the Soviet period was an interruption in the normal course of things, or according to Peter Winch, interruption or change of rules. Trust also influenced by behavioral patterns in the past experience. This is a consequence of the Soviet behavioral patterns. People of the Soviet period experienced limited access, what is very important, what comes from the past. Limited access to various forms of capital. Such forms of capital was limited. For example, salaries and wages, residential space, quotas for cars, garden house spaces limitation, and others. All our life planning depended not only on the objectives of people themselves, but also on the labor policy in the planned economy. Functioning in accordance with the principles of planned economy, education system also adjusted residents' personal plans. And at that time, the importance of social capital increases very much. And connection with other peoples, it was very important in this way because goods are limited. And about it, you can find Wright Lebedeva, Humphrey, Zdravomyslova, and others. And what happened? This is why people paid much attention to the accumulation of social capital. We not only guarded relations with the family, relatives, neighbors, and friends, but also paid much attention to social connection established during their learning, working in offices and other institutions. So great attention was paid to social connection behind the family when the family could not help or was politically unsuitable. Then, according to Robert Merton's adaptation models, so innovative conformist adaptation strategy was chosen to see owing to social connection, either inherited from parents or accumulated, publicly non-tolerated, but practically applicable protectionist measure to seen the set goal. The service for service practice was common. If useful relationships were not available, even having sufficient financial resources could not ensure access to limited goods and services. And what was very interesting, that people negatively view the political aspects of a totalitarian society. Yes, it was negatively positioned, but neutrally or positively view the everyday life of that time. So it means the double mentality, yes? So they perceive everyday life as saying at carne, non-political sphere. So non-political sphere. The adaptive ambivalence behavior is manifested. Different behavior and speaking, while separating the public and private spheres. It is not specific only for Lithuania. I think it's specific for all post-communist countries. As Arlaid Tart found the manifestation in 2006 of double mentality norms, and it found she in a different generation. So the propensity to innovation promotes the importance of social connection, and the resources of goods and services are limited. The limitation of services and goods associates people of different professions and social statuses. The service for service scheme, which became common in the society, involved representatives of different social strata and professions. Illegally taken out and appropriated products are exchanged for other scarce resources or difficult to access services. For example, one woman who were in charge in knitting craft at home privately without declaring their incomes. One of her survived gives the following example. My mother knit at home, father was a dentist. He also worked a lot after his working hours. They lived a very well off life, but my mother always dressed so that not to strike other people's eyes. Communist Party officials during the Soviet time also used such services. They also practiced the conformist, innovative behavior model. They used illegal services to satisfy their personal needs or those of their family members. They were also involved in the service for service scheme. One of the survivors provided an example of such behavior as follows. Together with other students, I went to a colchoz. One Communist Party official brought me a permit to go to Israel personally to that colchoz. You see how close relations are. So such conformist or such, relationship, they ignored ideological, social, and material differences because aim was welfare of your family or family members. What it means? That people devote their lives during the Soviet time into two separate living areas, political and non-political. Representatives of different social strata and profession choose, according to Merton's adaptation model, conformist model with innovative elements. At the same time, at home, yes, in the non-political sphere, they celebrated Christmas, it means some different, yes? They celebrated Easter, they celebrated some of an independent day, yes? So it means two different positions according the Soviet time. I am living here. I am conformist. I don't want to break the rules. But at the same time, I use communicative memories from my family, what happened in past, having in mind the experience. And what is very important, that situation can be changed, rules can be changed. But let's say the body of behavior is very connected to the family members. How the family members, which model of behavior we use. So the same can be used just in different social, economical, or political situation. So both trust is a two-way process. Trust is not only related to the level of detail, interest in purposeful, reflective judgment and information in the mass media. Trust is associated with political rhetoric, social policy management, security and welfare scenarios, and of course of criminalization, different criminalization scenarios. So let's say according to my example which I told before, let's say that in Lithuania we can say that dominated or with second scenarios. Not first scenarios on criminalization issue, but that second scenarios. Second, one reason for distrust, others are life experiences of their past life, of a distinction between public life and non-political private life. Such a distinction of a life forms the basis for the double mentality formation. We condemn what is intolerable in that context of the overall social environment, but we apply those practices, including violation of the rules, if they help to create personal wealth. So this approach forms the trust only those people who are involved in this peer networking. So I trust in others, but I distrust in others too. Other people cannot be trusted because they do not behave according to the rules, seek the welfare of family. So what it means that it's culture of trust. And that culture of trust can have different scenarios. And different scenarios, criminalization scenarios and our experience, they influence trust differently, yes? And for conclusion, what I would like to say that double mentality scheme was displayed in the new social, political, and economical situation. Is my explanation why we distrust others, why we distrust political parties, law institutions, because our experience, and not our experience, and behavior models of our family influence our behavior in our days and the present. Thank you.
Questions, comments?
What I find just, so I actually do not have a question. It's, I think that bringing this double mentality as a context to understand quantitative research is extremely important. I guess it will help to understand results, which are, for example, if some of you are familiar with victimization surveys, the work which Dr. Lapisepola does. So he has this Baltic paradox. So we trust police very much, but we do not report crime. And he calls it Baltic paradox. Why? So usually there is some relationship. So the more you trust, the more you report. The Baltics not. The level of trust is very high, but we rather would not report. And I guess the concept of double mentality is the one which is helping here to understand the situation. So we kind of trust it, but we better stay off. And I guess it also fits extremely well to understand the results with this Ministry of Interior, that we see police effective when it's tough and nasty. So it's something that we distrust, but we find then it is, if it is tough, it is the right policy. So it is effective policy. But if you trust it's too soft, so it's probably not
effective. But then I'm sorry, do you say about trusting police or confidence in police?
Okay.
It's about the moment. Of course, I can, let's say, I can be confident in police. So I suppose that it works. But I do not trust them. Because I suppose that they sell my attitude to criminals. And I never reported to police.
Yeah, it's better to stay.
Yeah. Like, but when you go with research, with quantitative research, you measure confidence in police.
Mm.
But next question is about the trust in police. You know, sometimes it's just the issue of interpretation. So.
But I think that this concept of double mentality is excellent. It widens the horizons and widens the horizons of understanding.
To continue. Now, it's not only a comment, but a question to Laima as well. Actually, in social psychology, this double mentality has its proper name. It's cognitive dissonance. So when you, at the same time, just keeping in your head two different issues. But in terms of your research on biographical research, I see some, maybe some...
You come here, you know, you're just having a dialogue, you and your friend, sorry.
It's not dialogue, it's a question for everyone. Double mentality means two different, attitudes to history in say existential philosophy. There are two different reception of history, so-called official history and authentic history. It seems to me Martin Heidegger expressed it in a very nice way. If I say that I first time I fall in love, the time when the first man did the first step on the moon, something wrong with my love, because it's not authentic. It's normal to be inside this temple. Why are you so stressed? If this I believe it, might be I'm wrong, but you stress negative aspect of this double mentality. But it's normal. It's normal in terms of socialization or. In terms of constructionism, internalization of our relationship. There are something where we together, mit sein in German, and there are other issues, socialization, where we just have our relationship with not with you and he, but with they. And we have a borderline. It's normal. It's not only for Soviet mentality. It's everywhere.
But if you look at figures in some researches and surveys, this general trust in other people, in Lithuania, and other Baltic states, like Latvia, Estonia, also is much lower than in Western Europe. So that's its. I think a little bit more related with the political systems, the repressive regimes that were present in our countries.
How we cannot say, for example, when we are living, living according to rules, we can hate that rules, yes? We can don't make attention, we can criticize at home, yes? But we are talking about the same rules, about nowadays situation, yes? But what happened, what Annette Carlin says, talking about double mentality. Yes, we are during Soviet times. So we are talking about our social career. Social career, it means I would like to be a Communist Party's member or so. I would like to believe in political official sphere in that rules, and I would like to behave according to that rules. Yes, but what happened when I come home? Of course, it's the same. We can, for example, criticize that rules, or we can talk about love, distrust, whatever. But what happened? That I forgot my social expectations, and I came back in the reality, which, like Soren calls, New Year's past. But New Year's past is quite different, politically, social, and economically. And I use continuity of social past in my present days. And it's double mentality that I behave according to such New Year's past. And when I close home door, I behave like social or Soviet person. I forgot my, for example, continuous or of my family, what we practice. And do not forget how many generations are, we can call it Republic generation. They have different experience, yes, because experience of life in interwar situation, yes, Stalinist generation. And later generations, so the socialization is more easy because Soviet time is like a normal. But for example, Republic generation and for Stalinist generation, so life is quite different.
Curiosity is, do you see any continuity? I'm interested in bribery, corruption, that type of area. Do you see any continuity between the Soviet period and now in terms of general values such as individualism, competition, solidarity, this type of thing? Or do you see a big difference? Or do you see any?
I see continuity, not big differences. Just situation that it will change, yes? Yeah. From collective to individualism, yeah. How to solve.
Does this determine any new developments?
Yes, because and the value system changes,
yeah,
not
changes, yeah.
At the same time like social changes, yeah. Political, economic, and cultural change.
Actually, I'm wondering whether you looked how people experience current political system and how they were experiencing back then, because for my family, I was quite surprised that by the time, by late 90s, they were actually saying, oh, actually Soviet time was better. And my family, yes, my family is quite nationalist, and I would never think that my grandpa would say, well, actually, the freedom is not good enough, or it doesn't work as we intended to, or it doesn't deliver the values that it was initially promising, because during 90s it was quite horrible period, let's put it this way, and it was kind of, yeah, money grubbing, and those who managed to get somewhere before everybody else did. So it was, kind of split mentality. And even in current times, my parents think that, well, Soviet times in a way worked. So it didn't matter exactly, as you said, that there was this double mentality. You just didn't talk about politics, and we don't care who's actually in the party, or you just kind of were not ignorant, but you just didn't care, and you didn't speak about politics because it didn't matter. Like, your social life was completely distanced from politics.
So we say that in 1990s,
yeah.
What we are saying now.
Yeah. Yeah, but even now they think that it was better then. So
it's many circumstances, like economical situation, crisis, so that affects. When you want to eat, you don't think about political freedom, maybe.
Well, it wasn't that people were starving to death during
Soviet
time as well, so.
But when you don't have hot water, well, you want to consider which time was better.
Yes, I just thought whether you compared or whether they reflected how this time they experienced this time or it wasn't considered.
We found it out that now the people after transformation, some of them says that in Soviet time was better. But why? Because it was very difficult when it's split in from position of different generations. Mm-hmm. All the generation, when the situation has changed, they have not such a what to do. Because they are old, they are like pensioners. And what they thought that with changes will come better life. Changes just allow you organize your life, so, and not bring some goods, what you do expect. It's a mentality or a tool. How do you expect it?
It's kind of, you adapt to the situation and you feel psychologically good at this situation because you adopt it. And when the situation changes to one or other direction, it's not necessarily it's to a better or worse, but the change by itself moves you from the zone of comfort. So you feel some...
I think it's a question about neoliberal policies, let's put it this way, and money and the system that is currently in place that they don't align with or they don't agree with this policy, current policies.
Maybe it's a more simple explanation. Explanation through shock that's happened in the field, in the transformation. And psychologically, the shock is not just spoil absolutely all practices.
But we need to look again, come back to Laima's research.
Yeah, okay.
And we see these two spheres. And if we take this private sphere, actually people are living in welfare state. So it's secure. You have your network of friends. You have your social capital, isn't it? And so you are living. It is quite safe and secure. And the political sphere, the outer sphere, is something you cannot influence. You just do not interfere. And you do not connect this welfare with this political sphere. So it's a frame in which you are living, and it was seen that something that cannot be changed. I still remember it was unbelievable what happened. In the end of ages. It was unbelievable. So it's like a miracle how this monster can collapse. So I guess what people are like longing now for, it's a safe security state, welfare state they've been living. So you are provided with the work, whatever work it is. You are provided with a shelter. So you cannot be a homeless person.
And you have the social capital.
Yes, and you have the social
one of the things that
capital. And my guess is what people are very like. So this is the security. What they missing? And why they tell that it was much better?
I wanted to bring in another layer. I'm not sure because I'm not a criminologist, and I've studied institutions, and it's a sort of different aspect or different type of institutions than you talk about, but it's just listening to you, I'm kind of trying to link those two things, and I'm not sure that I'm able to, maybe you can just help me. What I've been looking at is how people in Estonia, after the Soviet collapse, how they lost the social capital, and with it, they lost the ability to create and hold on to informal relations. So whereas we hear a lot of stories about the rest of Eastern Europe where informality has kind of taken over and bribery and various informal ways of dealing with life have become quite crucial, in Estonia it hasn't really happened properly. In some individual cases, of course, but when we sort of look at more generally at these relations, there's a huge amount of fragmentation. And one of the things that people have replaced it with and go and sort of achieve their goals or satisfy their needs is through formal relations. So let's say there is an elderly person who needs help the informal relations with the neighbors have repented to the degree that she can't go anymore and knock on the door of the neighbors and say, can you please open it? Because it's shameful, it's sort of, it's problematic. And the other person can't really offer that help either. So as long as there is some sort of formal arrangement where, which brings mutuality, which brings the ability to offer something back, people will use those formal relations. And this is a very personal example, very far from these kinds of institutions that you're talking about. But it can be seen to happen on this sort of, on that higher level as well, that these formal institutions are there to mediate relations that have disappeared. And I'm kind of wondering if this could be applied also to this trust, this sort of abstract trust in institutions like police and so on. I'm not sure, I mean, it sort of puzzles me, and I'm not sure if I made sense, but that's one of the things that I've noticed in my research, and I'm kind of trying to see if it makes sense in that level we talk about.
As I mentioned, two scenarios of criminalization. When you are living in paradise, so police is your friend. You believe in it. You think police will help you, yes. When you are living according to second scenario, it means we all are like rule breakers. And we would like to show that we are not rule breakers. In that case, police is not, or not just only police, prosecutor office and other law enforcement institutions, they are not our friends. They will be later maybe our friends, when we will from hell put into paradise. Then we say, oh, law institution is help us, yes, to be more, to feel my, myself more safety, yes, and in the society. So it means, and it depends on trust. In first scenario, my trust it can be higher. In second, because I am afraid. I am still living in hell, so. And political power, political or different groups' interests, they influence. So, like Rogerius would be told, society is not anonymous, yes. Just we say general population thing, yes. General population trust, general population idea, but question, what general population? General population what? So they have very, very, very concrete characteristics. They not just one like thing, yes, and calculated in this way.
Any more comments, questions?
Actually, I have one. I'm wondering about traffic police. How come they have so such a big trust? Because, well, in Latvia, they're to my mind, they would be the least trusted because usually they were associated with bribes.
Well,
because
yes,
you were passing by and just paying and then not getting any fines. So it wasn't the same. Or it isn't the same. Or they
well,
actually enjoy that they can just pay a bit less and then get away with it.
Well, I think it's one thing is how we organize their work. Another thing is public relations. I think people still somehow think that police, especially traffic police, is those people who take bribes.
Mm-hmm.
But the police is working very much on it, and they are placing cameras in the traffic police cars.
That doesn't work.
Well, we work, because people are, well, we cannot speak about 100% anyway. In some cases we work, in some cases we're not. But what we are doing much, very many media campaigns about not giving bribes to police officers, about you being watched in police car, you being filmed. We are putting a very good material about how many police drivers were also, let's say, we go to court because we are giving bribes to the police officers, especially traffic police. And we every week we put figures on the media that how many drivers were trying to give a bribe to police officers. So we create an image of a police force that doesn't take bribes. I think in reality people try to give bribes to police, but somehow we are starting to believe that they are not taking bribes.
It was before as well, much higher than any other institution, so it doesn't explain that.
I can continue with more concrete explanation. We have such research for several years in Lithuania. It's called the corruption map, map of corruption in Lithuania. And inside this research, we have some indicators, for example, the bribery level. For example, it means we just calculated our bribery index. It calculated how many cases we have among those who contacted with investigating institutions, for example, with traffic police. I believe, 10 years, we start from 2000. Yeah, well, for last 10 years, the index of bribery in traffic police was 0.5. It means that every second encounters with traffic police finishing by bribes. And it was until 2014. In 2014, the index of bribe reduced until 0.35. Actually, another data is that, again, according to our research, there are very strong correlation about roughly about 0.8 between trust in police, trust in institution, and imagination of the institution as a corrupted. It means it's very high correlated. If, for example, in this case, you have reducing in ranks of the evaluation of police, you immediately have an increasement in the trust of institutions. So it's explanatory. So it's real real improvement of working of traffic police. It's happening. It's a miracle that it's happening.
Well, I think that the other explanation that may be that they are improving their services very much because you can, well, I was taught to read, well, last year, right, police because of speeding, so I could pay it with my debit card. I even didn't have to get out of a car. We wrote a protocol, we were very polite, we were very nice, I paid fine. So it was very nice, like five stars hotel. Mm-hmm. So, and I think this is the policing culture we're speaking about, that makes people evaluations very high. So, and I think maybe we are a little bit more educated. I never made a survey about what education is of traffic police officers and patrolling police officers.
What
I think
the wage difference? Is that wage difference?
Maybe wage difference, maybe education difference. Some police officers with high education, some police officers without high education. So maybe it makes some sense in understanding the culture, maybe level, what they can provide.